at industry giants with Tony Bancroft, animator, author, and director.
That's right, and podcaster too.
And podcaster with your brother.
I have my own podcast with my twin brother. We actually both are in the animation industry, so it's called the Bancroft Brothers Animation Podcast. It's on iTunes, comes out every 2 weeks.
Yeah. Awesome. And so you were one of the youngest to win the Annie Award, is that correct?
Yeah, I don't know if I'm the youngest that won the Annie Award. I was the youngest
director.
that was chosen to be a director by Disney. When I started on Mulan, so I directed Mulan for Disney. I was 26, I think, and at that time, probably the youngest one in Disney history. And then, yes, after the film came out, I won an Annie Award for Best Director that year, which was awesome. That's because in our industry, the Annie is like the Oscar for animation.
Definitely. And real quick, I just want to point out how, you know, Disney said that, you know, anyone can make someone laugh, but it takes someone very special to make someone cry. And you guys definitely did a wonderful, beautiful job at making myself and thousands and millions of others cry with Mulan. That was just such an amazing
thing. It's our honor to make little children cry all over the world.
Yes.
And hopefully laugh too. So yeah.
Lots of laughing
balance,
in Mulan as
the
well.
The balance there, yeah.
Another character that in the Disney Hall of Fame that you've made, you know, me personally, I have laughed hundreds of times over is Pumbaa.
Pumbaa.
The most adorable warthog ever.
Yeah, the flatulence was my idea, just so you know. That was that didn't come from personal experience.
Not pretty
Yeah, it just came from, I've always done, you know, animators can be kind of typecast, if you will. And for me, it was a privilege to be typecast as the funny guy. So I did, you know, Cogsworth the Clock in Beauty and the Beast, a comedy character, and Pumbaa in The Lion King, and Iago in Aladdin, and Kronk in Emperor's New Groove. So I always got a chance to do these funny characters, and I loved it. It's a great way to spend your day drawing funny characters and funny expressions all day.
Do you have a personal favorite out of those?
I mean, I'm partial to Lion King, I'm partial to Pumbaa. That was my first opportunity to supervise a character, and at Disney, you start out as kind of a, you know, in a crew and helping out, because there's not one animator that can animate one character in the whole film. There's just too much work. So there tends to be like a crew of three or four animators. On Aladdin, believe it or not, there was 12 animators because he has so much presence in the film. But for smaller characters, like the side characters, three or four animators is kind of the norm. But on Pumbaa, I was the supervising animator, which meant that I got all the close-ups. It was kind of like being the lead actor and then not having to do your own stunts anymore or something. I guess that's the way I'd relate it. But I got to do all the close-ups and stuff and create the final design. The model sheets that are out there of Pumbaa and what he looks like are my drawings. So that was a real privilege for me.
Well, thank you for that.
You're welcome.
You
Hakuna
have...
Matata.
What a wonderful phrase.
Yes.
You also, one of the kind of, I feel like it's a very niche kind of area, you got to work with Miyazaki.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Voice direct his... was it Porco?
Porcoroso.
Porcoroso.
Yeah, it was one of his films in his canon of films. It was back in, this was years ago, when Disney made a deal with Studio Ghibli. And because Disney and us Disney animators were so into Miyazaki's work, it was so influential with us. I mean, literally on Rescuers Down Under, rather, the directors from Rescuers Down Under told all the animators and the layout artists, look at Miyazaki's work. We want to try and get that epic scope and that feel. So we really went out of our way and to study his work. So as much as he was influenced by early Disney, because that's what Miyazaki would say, that he was so influenced by Disney, we were influenced, the next generation was influenced by his work. And to be able to meet him, to be able to be part of one of his films, even though we were just taking the final film and we recast all the characters, we rewrote the script in English, but keeping very faithful, of course, to what the story intentions were that Miyazaki had for Porcoroso. But then my job was to oversee all the actors and stuff to make sure that the lip sync and the characters and the performance was there for the English version that was released here in the United States.
And that was Michael Keaton, right?
Michael Keaton played Porcoroso, yeah, the big
very
pig.
Cool.
Yeah, so it was cool working with Batman, you know? Yeah, it was awesome.
And so you've also done a ton of commercial work as well with Hasbro, McDonald's, Nestle.
After I left Disney in 2000, I actually started my own animation company. I was crazy, thought this will be easy, and started Two Nations Family Entertainment. We made videos for the faith-based market, was a big part of what we did. And then we also did work for hire things. So I went back to Disney and ended up doing commercials for them and directed video projects and stuff for Lilo and Stitch and then Hasbro and Mattel and a lot of the other toy companies and stuff. So yeah, that was a big part of the early 2000s for me. Yeah.
Very cool. And you also, you're working on a new movie called Animal Crackers.
Yes.
What are you allowed to share with us?
It's not just a fun cookie, but it's also going to be a movie coming out. We're making a CG animated feature called Animal Crackers, and it's really a labor of love for me. It's totally the opposite of what I've known working at Disney, you know, having all the resources and doing a big budget feature. This is a smaller, more independent, more personal film for me, which has been a lot of fun. Still a comedy. It's not like a big drama or anything, but has a lot of magic and fun and family values to it. We're deep into the trenches of it right now. We have an awesome cast. I mean, we brought back some of the voices that I worked with at Disney. The voice of Kronk, Patrick Warburton, is doing a voice for us. And the voice of, you know, Iago, Gilbert Gottfried, is doing a voice. And Harvey Fierstein, who I worked with on Mulan, we brought him in to do a voice. But then on top of it, Sir Ian McKellen, you know, Gandalf, is doing a voice. And
that's super.
John Krasinski and Emily Blunt, who are married in real life, are doing man and wife team in our film.
Oh, how fun
on
the
set. Yeah, and Danny DeVito, who also worked on Hercules. Yeah, we got an all-star cast. And so it's kind of like the little engine that could. I really feel like this is a film that's kind of grown up and become something more than we ever expected just because of the support that we've gotten and how we've just poured our hearts into it. So I'm excited about it.
And when is the release date about?
About the end of 2016, so end of next year. So
we've got a year.
We got a year. Got a lot of work to do, but we got a year, yeah.
Okay, cool. And you also have a book, Directing for Animation.
I do,
which is super cool. You can find on Amazon.
Right, yeah, and kind of the subtitle of it is Everything You Didn't Learn in Art School, because I really felt like through my experience of directing Mulan, like I said, I was very young. I did not know, I was kind of thrown into this world that I didn't understand of directing. And there's no classes for it. Disney didn't give us any training on how to be a leader or anything.
And it normally takes, you know, to get to directing it, Disney normally takes, what, 20, 25, 30 plus years. And you did it in what, like five
years? Yeah. From the point that I started right out of school, I became a director in 5 years. And it was pretty incredible.
Blessed.
Very blessed. Yeah, nothing, not about me for sure. But being able to do that and learn what I learned by making mistakes, by having a hard time, and it was a real roller coaster for me. Nothing I regret. I totally love working on Mulan, and it was the best experience of my life. But it was hard, and I learned a lot, and that's what I put into the book. I really wanted it to be for the next generation of all the things that I learned and didn't know going into it. I wanted to hand that down so that if anybody came into an opportunity like that themselves, they would be well prepared.
Well, that is fantastic, sir.
Yeah.
So definitely check out his book on Amazon. And you are just fantastic. Thank you so much for
coming
down to Texas.
You're fantastic, too.
Oh, well, thank you.
Good to be here.
Thank you.